Hello everyone, welcome to Analog IAS Current Affair Analysis for 6th April 2021. In this video, we'll be discussing these couple of issues. This article, The Pillars of an Equitable Post-COVID India, is about the rising inequality. Now, whenever we look at any macroeconomic indicator or the trend in an economy, especially in the context of Indian economy, inequality has been the biggest concern. This is because the issue of redistribution was often ignored. Now, in the pandemic, we have seen a case where the rich were getting richer and the poor were getting even poorer and suffered the most because of the lockdown. And this is not just an opinion, but a recent Pew research report showed that India's middle class may have shrunk by 33% in the pandemic situation. So this shows that the number of people earning less than 150 rupees per day more than doubled. So this report also told that the situation is actually getting worse, and even international institutions like World Bank are warning about the same things. Now, how do we handle this situation is the question that we have on our hand. Even before the pandemic, there were certain structural deficiencies in our economy. And the most important one amongst them was the informal nature of our economy. That is, a lot of businesses don't ensure that the employees get social security benefits. They are just informal in nature. So this has, for example, the share of wages in the corporate sector has significantly come down. And large companies, which were actually getting the benefit of this pandemic, did not pass on the benefits to their employees. The quarterly net profit of the BSE 200 companies, that is the top 200 companies in the Bombay Stock Exchange, has actually risen by 57% year on year. Yet the salary, or sometimes even certain companies, have resorted to pay cuts. They have not reversed that decision till now. So the informal sector and workers have suffered a lot with loss of incomes and employment in the last 1 year. In other words, the recovery was very slow than expected because of this inequalities. So this article suggests a three-pronged strategy. What is the three-pronged strategy? First one is to create jobs which gives gainful employment, that is rise in incomes. Secondly, it is talking about human development. In the pandemic, we have seen that the out-of-pocket expenditure increased further on health as well as education because of the online transition of education sector. A lot of companies have voluntarily donated cell phones and laptops to rural kids, but that was grossly insufficient. So out-of-pocket expenditure has increased, or even sometimes the pandemic has pushed a lot of people out of schools as well. So there is a need to invest on human development. Thirdly, we are talking about a social security net. In these times of uncertainty, finding a gainful employment is very difficult. In this scenario, what this article is suggesting is we come up with a quasi-universal basic income. What does it mean? Quasi-universal basic income is an unconditional transfer to a certain extent for a certain section of society. Now, how do we ensure this? Here is where the author tries to oversimplify things by saying that we have to increase our tax bases and budgets and come up with more resource allocation for the social sector. This is the part where it is not very convincing enough as a solution, because how do we do this is the big question. How do we raise the tax revenue? How do we tap into our non-tax revenues? How do we strengthen our tax base for more collections? All these factors were just mentioned, but how is not clearly explained in this article. So that is the gist of this article. The first article titled Losing the Plot on Women's Safety. This is regarding how the Maharashtra Shakti criminal law and the accompanying special courts and the machinery for implementation of this law follow the same cliche where most of the governments, when they were faced with the question of women's safety, somehow they believe that making a new law instead of enforcing a existing one will be better. So let us have a look into the present news item that we're talking about and why it is a problematic issue. So like I've mentioned, the bill's content reflects the absence of a larger consultative process. Now, what do you mean by this? So there is no understanding of the existing criminal laws, because they've actually brought out the same law without addressing the root cause, that is enforcement. For any criminal law to be effective, fair and just, what we require is there are certain parameters which are required. Let me explain what those are. So if we take a look at how our existing laws are functioning, or even before that, we have to understand what are the components of effective judicial processes. So firstly, we need a robust investigative mechanism wherein the perpetrator of these crimes are found out. Then we need a dynamic judiciary which tries these accused and subject them to a rigorous judicial inquiry. So what is to be followed with that is the need for infrastructure to store evidences, to gather evidences, and also to ensure that a scientific methodology is followed in this entire process. So what we need right now is this. We don't have the infrastructure required for effective implementation of the existing laws. Instead of addressing this problem, the government has actually come up with a new law, which is even more confusing. Instead of focusing on improving the infrastructure, the government has brought out unreasonable provisions in the guise of securing women's safety. If we take a look at the pattern of how crimes against women happen, mostly they happen because they are socially stigmatized. The perpetrators of these crimes get away because very often, as seen in a lot of cases, the sexual assault crimes are done by relatives or persons known to the victim rather than someone who is from a different place or an outsider. So the law actually does not recognize this. Often, the offenses against women occur behind closed doors or isolated places. And the major problem is we don't have eyewitnesses. So when eyewitnesses are not found, the prosecution and the investigative processes and the conviction becomes even more difficult. Secondly, we're talking always about death penalty without actually inquiring into its efficacy. If you take a look at the statute books, it has been around for a very long time and there is absolutely no evidence affirming its potency in ensuring that it will prevent all the future crimes as well. That scenario just did not happen, because even if you take a look at the Nirbhaya case, even after the Nirbhaya rape incident happened and the convicts were hung, there was absolutely no deterrence in the number of rape cases that we are witnessing every single day. Another issue with this death penalty case is the fact that upon research, it was found out that a lot of judges are scared to award death penalty because subconsciously they believe that if they make a mistake, they would be taking away the life of a person. So research has indicated that judges are very hesitant to convict a person when the punishment is death. So this makes conviction even more difficult, and there is always a chance that this sentiment can be misused by the convicts in manipulating the evidence and ensuring that they are shown in the positive light. Also, in this case, this Maharashtra Shakti law has a controversial provision which stipulates that investigation should be completed within 15 days, the trial should be done in 30 days, and the appeal should be done in 45 days. Even if well-intentioned, this will only result in improper investigation or trial. Sometimes it is very difficult to gather investigation evidences required in just 15 days. Nobody wants to drag the cases for a very long time, especially not the police department, because they have a burgeoning caseload and continuous pressure from all sections of the society is definitely what they would not want. So in order to avoid this, ensuring the effective legislation is of priority rather than a quick resolution. And one more important loophole is the law does not actually specify what to do if it is not happening or if it is not completed. The investigation is not completed within the prescribed 15 days. It is silent on that aspect. So having a look at all these issues and also the fact that there were a lot of redundant issues within the bill, a lot of women organizations have actually opposed this bill, and it was referred to a joint select committee. So it would be interesting to see how this would fare up in the longer run. So that is the gist of this article.